We've seen all kinds of applications that we can do with curves, things like arc length, doing revolutions to get surface area or volumes. We can also do things such as looking at what happens on wires and things like mass and center of mass. And you might say, well, okay, if we can do all that with curves of the form y equals f of x, can we do it with parametric curves? And the answer is yes. Indeed, it adapts very easily to this new situation. We just think about what do pieces correspond to. Now, if you memorize formulas, you know, like pi times f of x squared, maybe it's not so clear what to do. But if you say, look, don't focus on the formulas, focus on what things represent, then it's very easy to adapt. Indeed, it'll be pretty quick and fun. Well, let's take a look at a few cases to get us going. So we'll start with parametric curves and arc length. So we want to find the length along a parametric curve, where our parameter, we like to think of as time, goes from A to B. So maybe we're, for example, here, this is that time t equals A. Over here is time t equals B. And we move along the dotted line. Now, how do we find the length? Well, what we'd like to do is take this curvy thing and sort of stretch it. And whatever it stretches to, measure that length. Well, can we do it? No, it's kind of hard. But what we can do is mimic that idea and say, hey, it would be great if it was straight. So what we'll do is we'll chop our parameter. In other words, we're going to subdivide time up into little parts and say, okay, let's just sort of think of it. Instead of going smoothly from one to the other, we're just going to hop along to those points in time. So as I move along, I say, okay, well, here's my next point. Jump to my next point, jump to my next point. Now you'll notice it doesn't necessarily look like it's even. In other words, sometimes it looks like we move a lot. Other times, we hardly move at all. Well, that's because we're chopping up not our curve, but we're chopping up our parameter. And sometimes, parts of the curve, we move faster, so we cover more distance. Whereas other times, we move slower, we cover less distance. That's okay, no problem. Now you can see that this straight line chopping up is not a bad approximation to the curve. All right, it's not a great approximation. We still can see errors. But if we were to add those pieces up, we'd be pretty good. Of course, what can we do is we can subdivide time even finer. And as we subdivide time into even more pieces, lo and behold, we see our approximation getting better and better. And therefore, we say, if we could find the sum of these straight pieces here, that'd be a pretty good approximation to the total length. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. So here we go. Our length is about, of course, there's always a little bit of error, adding up our pieces, so that's what this means, our summing, the length of each piece. So how do you find the length of each piece? Well, you say, how much did I change in x? How much did I change in y? And that gives us two sides of a triangle. So in particular, we have our curve. We have our straight line here. That's approximating that part. We say, well, if I want to find that length, I look at a right triangle. There's a change in x, and there's a change in y. And now, the missing side, Pythagorean theorem, square root change in x squared plus change in y squared. It's really the distance formula is what we're saying here. Now, we say, okay, well, what can we do? We're going to introduce delta t. So these are changes in the x and the y. Let's introduce a change in the input. So we're thinking of things as functions of time. So we'll put a delta t here. Notice that on the inside, in the square root, well, it'll become a delta t squared in the denominators. And so if you look, these delta t's here would exactly cancel with that delta t there. But why do that? Well, when we do this, when we have a change in x over a change in time, what are we doing? We're asking the question, how is x changing? That says that this value is approximately x prime of t. So we say, aha, see, it's small change in x over small change in time. Change in output, change in input. And so it becomes a derivative. Similar, this part becomes a derivative as well. Now, of course, it's an approximation because it's not exactly the derivative, but it's close when delta t is very small. And we're thinking of letting delta t get small. So finally we say, oh, I just have to add up my pieces here, the square root x prime t squared plus y prime t squared, change in t, delta t. As we let our pieces get smaller and smaller and smaller, we say, okay, our sum becomes an integral because integrals are all about adding up. And our delta t becomes our dt, and there we go. Beautiful, nice formula. Nice formula. Now, we've learned an arc length formula before, namely the form y equals f of x. So you might remember that this part right here, what is this? Well, this is y equals f of x. Okay, well, if you remember that formula, it was what? It was 1 plus f prime squared, take the square root of all of that, and you integrate it. Well, that's exactly the same thing that happens. Square root 1 plus f prime squared. In other words, it reduces to what we did before, which is good. It should reduce to what we did before because we should be consistent. Consistency is a sign that we're doing something right. If we weren't getting a consistent answer, something would be very strange. All right, so now we have length. All right, well, let's tackle area. Now, here we go. Our goal is to find the area between, say, a curve and an axis. It doesn't really matter which axis we go to. So, how do we find area? Well, this goes way back to Calc 1. We say, well, we found area by thinking of breaking things up into little tiny rectangles. So, here's a little tiny rectangle. We say, okay, we'll find the area of this little piece, and then we'll add up our little pieces together. And so if we think of our formula for integration, we really have a height and a width. So for example, we oftentimes just write this as integral a to b, f of x dx. But the f of x represents the height, and the dx represents the width. So really, here's the area of one little rectangle, add them all together, get the total area, and life is good. So, how do we find our area with a parametric curve? The answer, we do something similar. So what do? Well, we need a height. So what we can think of is any point on our parametric curve looks like x of t, y of t. So our height is the y of t. If we're going down to the x-axis. The width. Now, this is the part you have to be careful about. Width is not just dt. It's not. Because dt is our change in time. It's not our change in distance. So what we have to do is say, okay, how do we figure out our change in distance? Well, what we'll do is we'll say, let's see, what is x prime of t? And then multiply that by dt. So think about what x prime is doing. X prime says, how does x change as I change t? So it's a rate of change. So dx dt is how much is x changing as we change t. If you times it by dt, well, that's how much did I change with respect to time times the time. That's a how far did we go? That's a distance. So when we add this x prime of t dt, that's what gives us our width. Now, here is where things get interesting. When we did this before, in other words, f of x dx, we were always like, okay, don't even have to think about it, because we always had this natural orientation, right? We went from left to right, so dx was great, didn't even think about it. We went from low value to high value. Now we have to be careful, because when we think about parameterized curves, if we think about moving along a parameterized curve, we can talk about moving in two different directions. Maybe we're going to go from left to right. Maybe we're going to go from right to left. It depends. And so there's sort of an orientation coming into play. So you have to be careful. You'll notice in this picture, we did something. we added a little arrow here. Now this arrow is important because it's saying which way does the particle go, because we're using the motion of the particle to help us set up the integral. Now, you'll notice here that with this particular arrow, we're going from left to right. So in other words, as we think about time increasing, x is increasing. So what this means is that x prime t dt is positive. Now, what if we had done something like this? We have a similar setup. In fact, we're going to have essentially the same curve, same region, but we had gone in the opposite direction. Now, what would happen? So here, we're going this way now. What happens to x prime of t dt? Well, because our x values were going from right to left, we're decreasing. In other words, x prime t dt would be negative. So what we'd have to use is our width would have to be minus x prime of t dt. So be careful. Take into account orientation. You have to check. This is why you might set up a problem for an area and come up with a negative and be like, what? Negative area? That doesn't seem right. Well, probably what happened was there was an orientation that wasn't taken into account. So that's something to keep in mind. Now, that's if we're dropping down to the x-axis. What if we go across to the y-axis? Well, certainly, no problem. We can do that. So if we have a curve and we want to go across to the y-axis, what do we have? Well, again, we're still going to have rectangles. So it's still a height and a width. We just have to think about what's acting as our various pieces. So in this case, if we have our point x of t, y of t, our width will be x of t. Our height, well, that's how much we change in the y direction, y prime of t dt. And again, be careful with orientation. So keep track. All right, so we can do area. And in a similar spirit, once we can do things like area, we can do volume and so forth and so on. Let's talk about one more. What if we want to do surface area? Okay, no problem. What do we do? Well, we think about our basic formula. You see, this is when knowing the basic formulas are very helpful. If you memorize just a collection of very special cases, we can't adapt. Whereas if we memorize a generic formula, we can handle pretty much anything they throw at us. So what's our generic formula? Well, it says you have 2 pi, you're adding up, and radius and length. And the basic underlying idea here is you start with your curve. Really, it can be any curve you want. It doesn't matter. So you start with your curve, and what you do is you split it up into parts. So this is our part. And now we ask the question, what happens when we spin that part? Well, spin it around where? Well, we can spin it anywhere. We could spin it around a line down here, for instance. No problem. So if we do, well, the thing we need to know is what's the length of the little part, in other words, how long is this little piece, and what's the radius, how far are we from where we spin? Okay, so our radius is some function of time, no problem, we just figure it out. And our length, that's like our arc length, and we just talked about that. X prime squared plus y prime squared, square root of that, dt. Then we're basically done. We're ready to go. Now, what's the radius? It depends where we spin. So there's 2 special cases. Suppose we wanted to do it around the x-axis. So if we want to go to the x-axis, our distance here is y. Y tells us how far we are from the x-axis. So our radius function is y of t. If we want to go to the y-axis, our distance there is x. So our distance is x of t, and so forth and so on. It's just a matter of saying, how far am I from where I'm spinning? And once we have that, life is good. We can do all sorts of fun stuff. So that's another example. Like I said, there's many more. We can do volumes of revolution. We can talk about what's happening on things like wires. Anything that we've talked about before that involves curves, we can still do with parameterized curves. And here's a case where, again, don't memorize lots of special cases. That makes it hard. And focus on what do the pieces represent. It breaks down into little parts and say, okay, maybe what is this piece? Okay, well, it's the radius. All right, what is this piece? It's the length. All right, good. And put it all together, and it works, and it's beautiful. And so let's go and do some practice using parameterized curves.